Hello? Oh. Yo, assalamu alaikum, how are you?
Good.
Good to hear. I'm going to sit down. Okay. I don't like to show off my height too much. Thank you very much for coming, everybody. It's been absolutely incredible being here in Karachi. I'm very excited about sharing some poetry. Shall we get into it?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. The way I like to run my sessions is I'm very fortunate that I do writers panels all around the world, and I like to have a conversation. I like to make this open. It's not necessarily about us writers being all fancy, sitting on a stage. Talk to me. Tell me what you feel. This is what poetry is. Let us make this room poetry rather than just poetry for the sake of poetry. Welcome. You're looking lovely, both of you. Okay. My name is Zahebzi Khan. I'm originally from Pakistan. Lekin, my passport says I'm Australian. So I would like to first introduce Zoha Jabbar?
Jabbar.
Sorry, meri Urdu thodi si weak hai. So Zoha Jabbar, who is... Jabbar. Zoha Jabbar, who is involved in spoken stage, please. Sit where you wish. Next we have Batul Hassan, who is the runner-up of the 2015 Pakistan Poetry Slam Championships. 2017. Where does the time go, na? Acha. And then we have Mariam Paracha, who's got the lovely purple hair. Mariam Paracha, who is the founder of Spoken Stage in Karachi. And then we have the lovely Charmaine, who is brilliant. And lucky last, Hamza Iftikhar, who is the 2017 Pakistan Poetry Slam champion. Okay. How are you?
Yeah, good.
Okay. Charmaine, shall we start with you? Would you like to share some poetry? Brilliant. Would you like to hear some poetry from Charmaine, ladies and gentlemen? Yeah, okay. Sorry?
So this poem is called Dusting. Today, I cleaned my parents' room, dusting away perfume bottles and Swiss knives with a damp cloth. I cleaned their room by myself, silently, quietly, hoping no one would walk in on me. All the while thinking of how funny it was that each of them blamed the other for the mess. I looked at empty and perfume bottles and took in their scent. Familiar, like home. Like Ma and Ba going to dinners and parties where kids weren't allowed. I looked at a hat full of my father's belongings, full of receipts and pens and keys, proof of things he'd been busy with. I cleaned their room and looked through my mother's makeup and put on her lipstick, a sheen on my lips. I found my father's medicine box. He has three boxes full, each box with seven parts, five pills each day of the week. And I thought to myself, when did this happen to his heart? I cleaned after their mess and moved away the dust that had settled over surfaces unseen for years and years, and somewhere between my father's hats and my mother's books were my little sister's headbands, comfortably draped over the frame of the mirror, silent, unnoticed amongst the grown-up things. I cleaned after their mess, hoping they would stop complaining about how dirty the carpet was, when they had left crumbs and thread and strands of hair everywhere. I cleaned up their mess like I always try to do, except this time I was a little less disappointed.
Thank you. Cool. Thank you very much, Shamanit. Would you like to share another?
Not
yet. Wasn't she lovely? Give her another round of applause, please. Mariam, would you like to kick it off next?
Sure. So I'm going to share two short poems, and it's interesting. They're both about body parts. I just was doing a theme, so I thought, why not continue with it? So the first one is called It's an ode to my eyebrows, basically. So the idea is that I grew up with a unibrow, and I keep looking at my baby pictures, and I'm, oh my God, mom, why didn't you get rid of it? And then I realized, you know what? This was a way for me to kind of accept who I am. So I thought of writing a poem about it, to accept who I am and just be proud of the way I look. And so this one's called Dear Eyebrows. You used to be one all on your own, like a thin, wispy, barely visible torso. You're a squirmer, such carefully curated trembling like a belly dancer's arms. Fidgety like a black-naped rabbit on a run, you are full and unruly like South Asian mangroves steaming with coastal heat. You accent all my troubles and my pleasures. You swell up, spilling from the bone like a river after monsoon. You're the surprise and joy my eyes cannot contain. You're wild and anarchic that only a thread is meticulous enough to tame, for 2 weeks to be exact. Your right side always seems to have more opinions than the left. You're so dramatic and so passionate, but I want to thank you for being the roof from which my feelings blare, for having an unstoppable tendency to overshare. So that's the eyebrows. Next is Zaban. This one's a little... This one isn't... it's not an oated, it's just an idea of the way we're made to watch our tongue. And there's this saying that I heard when I was growing up, tumhari zaban bahut lambi ho gayi hai. I'm not sure if you guys have heard that before, but that's what inspired this short piece. So it's called Zaban. Where I come from, we are often taught to revise ourselves. Demure is the cure for a lambi zaban. A long tongue is dangerous, he said. You can trip on it. You are not a dog, so don't look so thirsty. Only dogs are allowed to look thirsty. Tuck it back inside, he said. My teeth are welded shut. I have one tooth that hangs out of place. My mother's left tooth hangs out of place, pushed back, designed to cut the tongue down to size. The tongue is a killer whale. It needs room to breach and wail. My teeth, a loyal gatekeeper, patrolling the territory, even in my sleep. I cannot rid myself from this stronghold because my tongue tastes too much like you. Like your calloused, bitter melon fingers that I've always been holding to make sure that I don't trip. Yeah.
Thank you, Mariam. Let's give her another round of applause. My theory is you can never clap too much and you can never love too much. So please let it flow freely. Let it flow freely, the claps and the love. Thank you very much, Mariam. That was beautiful. I love the imagery throughout that poem.
Thanks.
Beautiful.
Would you like to go next, Zoha?
Okay. So this is a poem that I wrote about my father. And I've been writing a lot more about him because he fell ill over the summer. He had a heart attack. And it kind of got me thinking about our relationship a lot more. So here goes. I remember my father teaching me the dua for sleeping. Allahumma bismika mautu ahya. Oh Allah, in your name I die and I live. His voice, usually booming, was gentle as he said it. The dua for a peaceful sleep. My father has never had a peaceful night. I have been told I talk in my sleep. I snore and I grunt. But my father shouts in his sleep. He yells and he threatens. Sometimes he screams out names. Sometimes he yells out curse words. He thrashes around, bang, clatter, thump. His legs are on the bed while his body sleeps on a mattress on the floor. Through the walls of my room, I hear his heavy legs thump against the bed. He is kicking in his sleep again. Allah, he calls out. Next, he calls out his mother's name. Next, he complains about the bills. Bang, clatter, thump. He is thrashing about again. My mother sleeps on the bed, and in the 30 years of their marriage, she has learned to drown him out. She sleeps through his nightly tantrums. She knows she shouldn't wake him. In his sleep, at least he expresses himself. In his sleep, at least he feels something.
That was beautiful.
Zoha, may we hear another one? Only if you'd like to, obviously.
Okay.
Thank you.
This one is also about my father, and I wrote this just after his attack. Is it an angiograph or an angiogram? I can never remember. All I know is that his heart doesn't work the way it's supposed to. But I could have told you that. I've known for years. Telephone calls, I look at the screen until it stops ringing. They ask me how I am. I'm fine. My mother asks me if I want to talk to him before the surgery. I said no. She didn't ask again. In his hospital bed, he struggles to put on his socks. And I want to ask him if he needs help. I almost do. But someone else steps in, and I sigh with relief. There is a scar running down his chest where they cut him open, held his heart in their hands, and understood it better than I have in 24 years. The stitches are still delicate. Is he the same big, hulking man I was so afraid of? He's thinner now, and he coughs up blood. And for the first time in 60 years, he has to keep his temper in check. He's softer now, and I wonder if I know this man. We don't speak. We let silence ring through the tiny rooms of our tiny home, where dust coats the empty dining table. But sometimes, our eyes meet, just before we look away. Do you know you're at risk too? It might be genetic. Yes, I know. I've known for years.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dora. That was absolutely beautiful. That light is on fire.
I was just going to point that out. It's like maybe it's supposed to do that. I don't know.
It's supposed to do that.
It's okay. Lit.
I'm assured that it's supposed to do that. It's okay.
So. It's ko ban kar.
कोई बात नहीं ये पाकिस्तान है ये चलता है it's fine it's perfectly
okay नहीं ऐसे नहीं बोलना चाहिए
अच्छा अच्छा the mosquitoes are getting burnt
अच्छा okay
how versatile
sorry we're also fighting dengue fever and malaria at the same time there you go win 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 okay thank you very much Zohar that was absolutely incredible
it was amazing
Batul,
yeah.
Who was the runner-up at the Pakistan Championships?
Yes.
Can we hear a poem from you, please?
Yeah, sure. So this is a poem I wrote because I feel like I see a lot of mental health issues around an incredible number of people who I know and I love. And the thing about mental health is that it just doesn't go away with a snap of your fingers. It takes so much time and there's a feeling of helplessness I feel when I see somebody who I love suffering from something like that. And this poem is just capitalizing on how I want to create something that could just make something like that go away in an instant. It's called Malpractice. If I was a doctor, or your doctor to be more precise, I'd experiment a lot on you. There would be a pill for making you pee out your depression, a pill for making you ingest your panic attacks, a pill for making you sneeze out any mood disorder. Sure, after my prescriptions, you'd be the equivalent of a smelly, bedwetting three-year-old or that uncle who's too gassy after a meal. But at least you'll still be alive. If I was your doctor, I'd take an MRI to detect all the dark energy that resides in your cerebellum and smoke it out to the sky. It'll rain, and all the flowers will start growing again. That includes you. If I was your doctor, I'd cut you open, suck out all the malaise inside you with my mouth, and spit it in every shampoo bottle of the world as serum for taming unruly hair. At least there'll be none inside you. I know I'd probably be sued for malpractice, but hey, I'd stop at nothing to make you feel better. You will thank me later. I will exorcise your demons out of you. Your insides are going to feel like chicken soup and your body will feel like cotton candy and there will be a smile on your face and you'll get a good night's sleep. I know it's been a while since you've seen the sun.
Wow.
That was beautiful.
Thank you, Bertul.
Thank you.
That was beautiful. Would you like to do another?
No, I'm good.
She's good. All right. Lucky last. Thumbs up.
Okay. I am a 21-year-old bald person. And so for this poem, I've decided to basically question my hair, basically. Like it's a one-sided conversation. And it's called The Hairy Inquisition, aka Questions with My Hair, aka Rest in Peace. And if you guys like connect or like feel anything, like it's a part of like a poetry slam to just snap along or like, you know, like get the energy in the entire space flowing because it's really stagnant right now. So this is a hairy inquisition. Assalamu alaikum ji, aap ja kahan rahe hain? Is it because my shampoo has silicone in it? Sulfates? Tel chahiye? Should I have listened to my amma on all those Sunday mornings when she offered to run her dripping hands through your friable waves? Why are they so friable anyway? Why have your once crashing waves slowly turned into desperate splashes until soon only delicate ripples guided anxiously by comb will traverse the Chikna wasteland? Is this how the ocean felt when its land was reclaimed? Why is it even called reclamation as though we're taking back what's rightfully ours? Does anyone really look at it that way? Why are people so entitled? Why do people only know how to take? Do you even feel? Does it really matter? Yaar, do you even know how old I am? Aap 10 saal aur ke liye tashreef rakhe na? Is that so much to ask? Is it because Baba was a Tindu at this age too? Do you resent me for not heeding to his consistent warnings? Is it because all my mamus are Tindus and have been for as long as you can remember? Do you resent the genes you're made up of as though you were scammed? Like you were just set up to fail because of whose you are? Like the harvest from an exhausted, heaving field that just doesn't have much to offer to begin with? Do you think I'm expecting too much from you? Do the expectations sit like lead burdens on your chest too? Do you feel like you can't breathe sometimes? Can you even imagine anything being different? Or do you see your early departure as inevitable under all circumstances? Because nature and predestination and lack of faith in hair pills and supplemental zinc. Do you even feel, does it really matter? Yaar, do you think this is fair? Did you not feel awkward when that Kareem driver asked me whether I was a student or teacher when picking me up from university? Did it make you feel anxious when he looked at you and asked me, "Sab theek hai na?" And chuckled to break the thick silence I created after telling him my age? Does it make you uncomfortable because that same interaction seems to happen every time you decide to close up a follicle? Sab theek nahi hai kya? Is that why you envy the butter puff crumbs settled on the peripheries of my mattress? Is that why you detach and punctuate my slumber surface like wiry thoughts that punctuate my mind? Do you even feel, or is that just me? Is all this just me projecting problems onto a part of myself that I've detached myself from so much that I see it as a separate entity? Does keratin even have the capacity to empathize? Do you feel upset when I hide you underneath a cap like a nihari stain on a white kurta covered by compulsory crossed arms? Like a skeleton in my closet, I refuse to acknowledge or condition. Like a Pakistani child on a gap year. Like a waste of scalp space, do you miss the wind running through your form? Do you resent me from keeping that from you? I was trying to avoid bald spot exposure. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry for the hiding, the loathing, the cap suffocation, the nihari stain treatment, the lack of tail, the emotional burden, my emotional burden. I'm sorry for the razor. I'm sorry for the chikna dome. I'm sorry they made me hate you. Maybe we'll hang out again sometime, post-potential Nawaz Sharif-esque graft. Dekhenge yaar, khudafiz. Thank you.
You can keep going. Thank you. Thank you very much. I reckon you look great, but the way
Thanks.
You are.
That's very sweet.
Can we hear another?
No. No.
Thank you. Would you like to hear one for myself?
Yes.
Okay. I'll do this one. Could you just pass my book if that's okay? Thank you. Shukriya. Let's give him a round of applause too. Look at him. I wasn't going to do this one. Oh shit, I remember why. So I apologize for my profanity. I remember why wasn't going to do this one. Because I use a lot of Urdu and Punjabi in my poems. And being the Australian-born fourth generation Pakistani that I am, my Urdu is terrible. My Punjabi is terrible. Lekin when I'm in overseas countries, they have no idea. they're like, va, 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 kya baate? You know, they're very impressed with my foreign language. However, I still a little bit of Iqbal. I'm told I say it wrong, but I'll do it right at the start. And the only reason I'm doing this is because of Zoha's poem in response to you.
Oh.
My God, this is embarrassing. Chalo. Khudi. خودی کو کر بلند اتنا کہ ہر تقدیر سے پہلے خدا بندے سے یہ خود پوچھے بتا تیری رضا کیا ہے. AKA, before every step you take and decision you make, my son, make your conviction so strong that God himself will pause fate just to ask you what you would like to do next with your next step. This is a lesson I learned from my father, who learned it from his father, who learnt it from his father, my great-grandfather, a man who in 1901 left his home in a land now known as Pakistan to land on Australian shores, for he was young, passionate, and ready to explore, and I can't begin to believe what it would have felt like for a man of only 19 to leave his home, newlywed wife and child on the way, and stand at Bombay port in front of a ship bigger than anything his eyes would have ever seen. I like to believe I'd be a lot like he. For he was born to explore. Born to a long lineage of warriors of war, and I know there's a lot of warrior in me, for four generations of my family have called that land home, and despite my skin tone and sexy subcontinental big nose, this is my home. This is my land, and I say it courtesy of a great man, my great-grandfather, the warrior. A man who in 1901 waged war with the world and boarded a boat to a new life. 112 years later, I sit hospital bedside watching my father wither. Cancer's taken his lungs and his heart don't beat blood so good no more. He believes he's weak, but he's not weak. He is a warrior. My father is a warrior. He is the grandson of a warrior. And I know my grandson will tell tall tales of his great-grandfather, a man who forged frontiers and raised a son who wasn't afraid to stand on stages and share his soul. My father is a warrior. Thank you, my warriors. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
May I do another?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Ah, you guys, stop it. All right. Sorry. Okay. This is my pop poem. This is my poem. Wherever I seem to go, everyone seems to enjoy it a little bit. Yeah. Hopefully I don't get chased out of the country as a result of it. Let's do it. It happened once. Cello. See if you can pick the line where it happened. Imagine. Imagine a world where people are treated as equals. Imagine a world where people are not categorized by skin tone, religion, gender, or size. Imagine a world viewed through the innocence of a child's eyes. Imagine no sorrow when a soul dies, for a soul flies after closed eyes. We try to live our lives in New York minutes. We be pushing our lives to new world limits and new world orders, while the old world still busy burying daughters. But they prefer sons. Only for those sons to pick up guns. Only for those sons to pick up guns and kill sons of righteous ones, and those righteous ones kill their sons. That those sons killed their sons, so their sons killed those sons, and sons kill sons, and sons kill sons, and sons kill sons, and Sun Tzu was wrong. For there is no art in war, for art is love, and there's no love in war. Imagine we loved more. and loved for the sake of love, for the love of love is the best love above all. Imagine a world of no wars and hearts, with no doors exposed raw. Imagine the life of another being the life of a brother. Imagine every embrace filled with the love of a mother's. Imagine a world of no strangers and only kindred neighbors. It's about time hatred gets outdated and our differences are celebrated. For our forefathers waited, but we, the people, shall wait no more. Today we take our stand. Imagine no French burqa bans and bikinis in Afghanistan. Imagine Hong Kong Hanukkah and white Christmas Mecca. Imagine no offshore refugee process prisoners and a history of indigenous prime ministers. Imagine Palestinians marry Israelis and make beautiful beige babies. Imagine. Imagine a world where people are treated as equals. Imagine a world where people are not categorized by skin tone, religion, gender, or size. Imagine. Shukriya.
Thank you.
Please continue your class for the rest of the panel as well. They were amazing, were they not? Okay. All right. We having a good time? Like I told you, I like to have conversations with you. This is all about people. And that's how I find the poetry is about having conversations. And I find there's a conversational tone amongst all of our poetry here. I would just like to start with Maryam and Hamza. Both of you dealt with issues of like body image. Both of you dealt with issues of, this is open to the rest of the panel as well, obviously, but you two in particular dealt with body image. Do you think that slam poetry is an adequate means of making yourself feel better or worse about yourself? Tell me.
So I think, so the way I dealt with it again was trying to find the positives in the things that made me feel bad about myself. So it's a good way to kind of lay it all out, I think, because sometimes when we're feeling negative thoughts, we just let it brew in our brain and we just start let it fester and it becomes worse. I feel like putting thoughts on paper and then actually speaking it out to people who might come afterwards after a performance and be like, oh my God, I related to that or I connected with that. I think it's a really good feeling. It makes you start love yourself.
It's hugely empowering.
Yeah, it is, definitely.
It's hugely empowering. And I feel like with spoken word, like outside just body image also, like anything that's happening, you know? Yeah. Like if you can write it and you can actually channel it into something that's not just negative and doesn't make you feel like
you can
bad
own
all
it,
the time. Yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
So that's the best part.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, there's just this feeling that's brewing inside of you when you put it into words. It's just you're processing and it's cathartic.
Yes.
Put it out there.
It's very cathartic.
And it also helps to have that medium there where you can say things that you normally wouldn't in, you know, real life.
Yeah.
So it's a very cathartic.
Cathartic seems to be the word. Yeah. And you all generally also have, myself included, have a running theme of family. Is anybody's family actually here? Yeah?
They're outside.
All right. Hello, family. You must be very proud. Okay. Well done, well done.
I think it's just Pakistan, like the culture is so family-oriented, right? We grow up with, sometimes some of us grow up with our cousins and then our grandfather and grandmother, all of us. It's so built in our family that I feel like a lot of us have come across poems that we've at least written once that includes our mom or our dad. Those are the main, I think, ideas that we face. But I think it has a lot to do with the fact that we grew up here, I think.
And sometimes you want to share them with your family and sometimes you don't.
Right. Yeah. So that's why we don't invite them when we do it sometimes.
It seems like because a lot of them are conversations that you don't have at home, and then poetry becomes that medium where we start to talk about things that you normally wouldn't.
Yeah.
And like things you can't say to your parents.
But you see, right.
Yeah, and you're airing your dirty laundry sometimes.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But again, it's a poem after all, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the thing is that the ideas that we express in our poetry, everybody has them on their heads too.
Yeah.
Everybody has something that's bugging them that they're keeping inside of themselves. But with slam poetry, there's just a medium you can use to tell everyone about what you're feeling and they'll be like, oh, it's okay, I'm not crazy.
Mm. Yes.
There's an anonymity that comes with it as well.
Yeah.
You can always just, it's you, but it's also not you. And it doesn't have to be your voice,
yeah,
but it ends up being a voice for a lot of people, mm-hmm, at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty liberating to like tell your story in a room full of strangers.
Yeah.
Like, here, I'm putting my
it's
heart
huge,
out
there. Yeah.
There you go, you know me now.
And yeah, that's what really like takes it away from like the page also, because I feel like that just that process of like speaking your own words is like so vulnerable and intimate, yeah, with the audience that it doesn't even really stay like an audience and performer interaction anyway.
Yeah. Incredible. And I can see that, I'm sure we can sense that how hungry they are to express their opinions and how hungry we slam poets are to express our opinions. It's good. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. Now, do you think that Pakistanis have a unique voice to share with the rest of the world? And what is that voice? Let's start with Batul, because I really enjoyed your conversational tone throughout your entire poem. It was the fact that you dealt with an issue such as mental health,
yeah,
was great, but maybe I was wrong, but I sensed a little bit of humor almost. Yeah. There was this undertone of the manner in which you had that conversational tone. It was great. So please, can you elaborate?
Yeah. So the thing is, we all have problems, right?
Come on.
We all have, yeah, problems, but talking about it is just gonna make it more bearable. So that's the thing with spoken word, is that because I can put my creative energy inside it and I can include humor, it makes it a little easier to talk about it. It removes the stigma attached with certain things like mental health. And as for having, like Pakistanis do have a unique voice. So I have this one poem where I'm just angry at my cousins. They come from abroad. And they're like, oh, Pakistan.
Can you do that one?
Would you like to hear another poem from Batul?
It's very good.
Please.
I think so. I hope so. Wait a second, guys.
That's okay.
Yeah,
my theory is a poem does not need an introduction. A poem should speak for itself. So rather than telling us about the poem, Batul, we'd love to hear it.
Okay.
How's everyone feeling?
I have
feeling?
So many poems on my phone. Like, whenever I'm angry, I'm just like, oh God, let's write something. Let's not scream at someone.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's the beauty of spoken word, is that, yes, everybody needs to share their feelings, but when you write it down and then you edit it, it's not a rant anymore, mm-hmm, so people are willing to hear it.
Yeah.
It's a bit more well thought out, because when you hear somebody whining or ranting, you're like, okay, please maybe stop, right?
Yeah.
But this, I think, is a good way to kind of articulate your feelings.
Yeah. Yeah. I found my phone.
We'll come back to that. You're on a great tangent. We'll definitely come back, okay, to that, Batul.
So this poem is called Third World. Dear Pakistan, I tread on your terrain like an extraterrestrial. The words Pakistani printed and passport are perturbing when heard of simultaneously. If speaking in a language was an exercise, Urdu would be a 20-minute plank. And given the opportunity to leave your soil, I will. But it's Shadi season these days, and my cousins have come abroad, or from Bahar Se, as we like to call it. And they're here, and it's Dawateen after Dawateen. But they tell me that all my dresses are tacky. They tell me that speaking in Urdu, I'm sorry guys, I can't,
okay,
I don't have the proper poem with me right now.
Oh no.
Yeah. Yeah, and they call your preferences desi as if that were tacky. That moment will yank the nationalism out of you. Why, yes, I mean war. Bring in the chutney and garam masala. There will be fire. I want to do nothing more than wrap you up in a pan ka patta and feed you to the tandoor. Dear Baharwala, this isn't the third world. This is the first country you will run back to after Trump ditches you. Regardless of how melodious your accent is, your whitewash cannot take away the brown on your skin. Better learn to love being sun-kissed. And don't pretend like you don't need us or this land. That you only come here to come here for your plans or to meet the family. When you'll get married, this is the land that will supply you your desi sexies, more curvaceous than the gold rotis you try to cook to sustain yourself when it's snowing outside, hotter than the chai your tongue can't handle. This is the country where no matter what happens, the sun always shines. This is the land that will never let you go cold or hungry or lonely. This isn't the third world.
That's her winning poem, by the way.
Yeah. That's her winning poem. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much for sharing that, Bartul.
Thank you.
Cool. We've got about 15 minutes or so left. We're going to open up the last 10 minutes or so for questions and answers. But since we're doing that, does anyone else like to hear a poem? I would love to hear another poem. You only got one. Yeah.
So, since we talked about body image,
we got plenty of time. It's all right. Okay.
So this one is called Chub Rub. I hate the chub rub I get when I walk too much. I have walked too much. Too many miles in a body that I hate, a body that I do not want. The body that is a burden. I am tired of walking because every step I take is one step forward, two steps back. I am tired of arms so big they jiggle when I'm happy and remind me I am not supposed to be happy just yet. Arms that hold people I love, arms that are strong enough, but arms that are not sexy. I am sick to the stomach because of my belly. I feel like never eating again, but I do. I eat everything in sight because I love myself, I say. But secretly, I think it's to punish myself for letting myself get this way. I am exhausted, sketching out the geography of my body. It's cartography I cannot handle. The lines are not straight enough. The surface not flat enough. There are bends in the road that lead nowhere, and I am yet to find a home.
Can we fix this microphone? I think it's... There you go. Cool. Give her another round of applause, please. Once again, we see the concept of body image coming up, that self-love, that, you know, getting those ideas out there. Do you think that everyone should be a slam poet, young, old? Because we look at the... As we look at the panel right here, we've got two bookends at the end. However, in the middle, we've got incredibly young, strong women, you know. And Pakistan, do you think that Pakistani women get enough of a voice? And do you think that there should be more within slam poetry? Mariam.
Yeah, definitely. That's actually part of the reason why, like, I started Spoken Stage was because I don't think we have a platform to share our work at all. And that was the reason I wanted us to come together. And I feel like... For us to be able to share our work, we should have a community because that's the best way that we'll learn, share, and become better. And I feel like Pakistani women specifically, like I mentioned in my poem, that, you know, we are not used to speaking out, speaking. And I think Zoha has a poem as well, which is called Takalluf. Yeah, so she talks a lot about that idea as well, how we're made to shut up. And I think it's a great way to let women just be honest and open about everything. So yeah, I think Pakistani women need it specifically.
Do you think slam poetry attracts a particular class of women in Pakistan?
Well, language, obviously, in Pakistan, since Urdu is the main language, I feel like because we've been exploring it mostly in English, it does attract the higher class, the upper class. But we have that, my aim was always, like, we always try to go to other schools and encourage spoken words. We recently went, Zindagi Trust called us as well, and we did a workshop with them. It was, again, body image and a bit of, yeah. So we try to reach out to other women, but then we realized that, again, we realize spoken word is mostly just about sharing your voice. So rather than imposing specific slam rules, we've opened it up more to spoken word and sharing stories. So storytelling. So we have, again, like Pakistan Poetry Slam also has Urdu and Punjabi poets who come as well. It's similar with the slam that we had recently. We had Urdu poets who came as well. So it's opening out more, again, because slam is a very Western concept. I think it has started off with the upper class, but we're really trying to penetrate through other classes.
A very rich oral tradition.
Yes.
So
yeah, and trying to mix it up. Yeah, exactly. So, yeah.
Yeah, incredible. Thank you. Batul, you use a lot of, you sparse Urdu throughout your poetry.
Yeah.
Do you think that your poems are accessible to an outside audience, outside of Pakistan?
No, because when I'm mostly performing here, I want to be, I want to say something that most people can relate to and most people can enjoy. Because I feel like it's about the people more. For me in poetry, I want everyone's voice to be heard. And I feel like there are a lot of similar things that we all worry about that I could say in a poem, which is why I like using Urdu and adding that touch to it.
Great answer. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Hamza, how are you?
I'm okay. I'm
great. Have you fallen asleep on us?
No, I'm fine. Just thinking.
So the juxtaposition of what Mariam was saying in regards to giving young women a voice. We have this idea within Pakistan and all over the world of what a man is supposed to be. And do you think that slam poetry gives a voice to an alternate vision of what a man is? And do you see that within Pakistan and abroad?
I think what spoken word poetry does is that it makes you very vulnerable. And I don't think like that vulnerability can be categorized like any gender, really. But at the same time, structures of masculinity in Pakistan are very, very rigid. And so there's like very little room to deviate from that stuff. Like, so the norms are absolute. And if anyone can bring vulnerability, humor, intimacy, anything within that, and to show that, hey, that's a dude, he's doing it, you know? Like, that's fantastic. Because, like, sexism and patriarchy affects everyone. Like, everyone is pigeonholed, and you just need to realize it's really not worth it. It's really not worth, you know, just, like, being consumable at, like, any level. When you are sort of compromising on your own authenticity. So I think spoken word does allow you to be more authentic. And so, yeah, it does sort of break that.
Brilliant answer. Thank you. Oh, you can clap that, definitely.
Thanks.
Hamza, would you like to do another poem? Would you like to hear another poem from Hamza?
Okay.
Only if you want to.
Okay, let me try and find one. Then, like, I'll get back to you.
Otherwise, Zohar, I'd love to hear one from you.
Okay.
Yeah, the one that we were mentioning earlier. Maybe.
Okay. Cool.
Something I didn't happen to mention at the start, and Hamza touched on it. If there's something that you really enjoy in the middle of a poem, rather than clapping, rather than throwing things at the stage, what you can do is just a little click. If there's a line that really hits you right there, give them a little click. If a line really, really hits you, have a little I do that in Australia and all the white people look at me very funnily, but we can do it here too. Please. Let's go. Hamza, are you ready or?
I could be ready.
You could be ready? Acha. Kya confidence hai aapke? Okay, please.
Okay.
And then Zohar.
This is the first poem I ever wrote. It's called I'm So Sweaty. I'm so sweaty. I'm so sweaty, Poseidon is jealous of the amount of water that envelops me. I'm so sweaty, Abdullah Shahghazi freaks out every time I pass by. I'm so sweaty, cacti die of overhydration when I touch them. I'm so sweaty, I pet my friend's kitten and drowned it. It was small and cute, and its tiny body and fragile lungs stood no chance against my saline tsunami. I'm so sweaty, I could reverse land reclamation. I'm so sweaty, I could solve the DHA water crisis. I'm so sweaty, Berria Town might steal me too. I'm so sweaty, I bumped into a girl at the school dance and she gave me this look of disgust, as though I exploded a goat's eyeball in her mouth, a look of disgust only a father could share with his son. I'm so sweaty, I could grow rice on my back. I'm so sweaty that my eyeballs are jealous of the volume of excretion. I'm so sweaty because my sweat glands haven't been beaten into submission the way my tear ducts have. I'm so sweaty because the tears need to get out somehow. I'm so sweaty because my skin isn't tough enough. I'm so sweaty because I need an extra layer of moisture to act as a buffer for life. I'm so sweaty because when I exist at the center of the Indian Ocean, society's bullshit turns into mere baby ripples of grime on my skin. I'm so sweaty because it's easier to wipe away those ripples. I'm so sweaty so that you can't make me sweat. Thank you.
Shukriya, va va va. Okay, Zoha, can we hear one from you too, please?
So this one's called Takalluf, that Maria mentioned earlier. It was about the untranslatability of words. So in Urdu, Takalluf is the pain and effort one goes through to make someone else comfortable in order to adhere to a code of formality, hospitality, and etiquette. And it shares its roots with Takleef, pain. I remember frowning at my mother when she handed me a half full plate of rice. She pressed a finger to her lips and with her eyes flashed me a quick apology mixed with a warning to stay silent. I looked over and saw my father's plate, full to the brim, and I understood. There was only enough for him. My mother grew up this way, and slowly she was teaching me to do the same. My mother killed pieces of herself so that my sisters and I could live. My mother can speak in Urdu with quick wit and a softness that cushions the harshest words. She speaks in Sindhi with humor and Memni with fire. She can laugh in Punjabi and sing in Saraiki, but in English she stumbles between do or does and is or are, and her eyes well up with shame. She made sure that never happened to me. I can speak in fluent English, but I can't speak to my mother. In my mind, I create forest fires, but when I open my mouth, my Urdu barely lights a candle. I asked my mother why she did that, and she smiled her sad smile and said, "But see how beautifully you write." I widened my eyes, "But you haven't ever read anything I write." She shook her head and said, "But other people can." And so what if you can't share your work with your mother? You can share it with the world. I have not been selfish with you. And so we returned to our usual way of communicating. Her English fell short and my Urdu felt ashamed. And instead we raised our voices to compensate for the feelings we lost along the way. I found one language, but I lost the others. She lost one language, and she also lost her daughter. My mother lives in the plains between sacrifice and pain, between takalluf and takleef.
Wow.
That one gets me every time.
Thank you.
That one gets me every time.
I paraphrase, I hope I got it right. My mother killed pieces of herself so that my sister and I may live. Give her another round of applause, please. I think the only person we haven't heard for from a second time is you, Mariam. Would you like to do another poem?
Sure.
Would you like to hear a poem for Mariam? Yeah.
Yes.
Haven't they all been great? Give them another round of applause, please.
And if we're doing family, I thought.
Chalo, please.
So it is called While He's Gone. You had become an expert at helping people go. You knew exactly what they needed if they were going to palm tree skies or to breath that always looked minty fresh. You had become an expert at filling bellies. You knew exactly how to gauge the potential of the suitcase according to all scheduled meetings and recreational activities. You had become an expert at letting things through. You knew exactly how to pull the thread through all his loose buttons while you waited for him to come back. You sewed back his negligence with fingers suppressed with haldi that pushed deep into your nails like a home remedy for faster fingers. You watched reruns of Who's the Boss switching between reverse gender roles and Madhuri Dixit. When you ran out of buttons to sew, you opened up the window so the dust can bake you a cake on the shelves, so you could eat it all on your own with one clean sweep. It is your birthday. Every day the clock is like a seesaw you sit on all alone. While he is on a swing set with his feet pushing the ground, he knows how to move on his own. We keep shedding like the moon, glowing like torches inside us. Take your turmeric magic and build a fire with the friction of your spine and your mind. Sprinkle it on crackling heat, because we all need fire to keep us warm.
Mm. Wow. Wow. That was cute.
Okay, we're nearing to the end of our panel. We're going to open up to questions very, very shortly, but I think it's only fair. Would you like to hear a poem for myself?
Yes.
Okay, all right. So much to Aria now, when I do my poem, I'm not speaking too fast with my Australian accent, no? Okay. All right, let's do this one. Lost. We're lost on consumer crisscross grid streets, listening to hip-hop bass beats mixed with guitar riffs from guitar riffs of gone by years. Our ears hear the dumb diddy dumber drums as we succumb to the rhythm and rhyme of gone by times. Line after line, false soul scoops a soul to young souls who grow old too fast and are taught to mask true selves. For true selves ain't swell, ain't cool, ain't swag. Ignore the price tags and buy the nice bag. For London, Tokyo, Paris, Hilton told you so. And the truth be on a need-to-know basis. For advertisers dictate what your taste is by chucking famous faces next to product placements. And adjacent to that, there's a cartoon cool camel smoking silky smooth cigarettes. And smoke these cigarettes and you will stress less and get more sex. But let's not overcomplex the context. I'm just saying sometimes more is really less. For the more you get, the more you want. The more you want, the more you spend. The more you spend, the more you gotta make. And if you can't make, then you gotta take. And then you take, and then you take, and then you take, and then you make a fake WMD war on terror so you can take just a little bit more. So your precious walled streets don't fall. And an unholy war was declared some time ago on the minor folk, i.e. us, you, me, and we. Let it, for we turn wants into needs and needs into wants. And those who make the wants want us to want the wants so much that we'll put 0% down but pay 19.9% per annum for the next 44 years interest compounded daily. And such is the nature of our crazy lazy consumer culture, a culture where banks loan loans only for banks to take homes when rates rise. But to avoid rate rise, you need to fix rates. But fixed rates be fixed in a match fix kind of way to make more money for the money making. Mr. More money's more money, more problems. And money's why Middle Eastern fists rise. And money's why Wall Street got occupied. And money's why Iraq got occupied. And money's why Afghanistan, Vietnam, Kuwait, Korea, Libya, Bolivia, Chile, Colombia, Peru, Cuba, and the Palestinian territories got occupied. For these lies. These lies started some time ago. These lies started some time ago, sometime between messiahs on crosses and crosses on bling bling lockets, sometime between atom splitting big bangs and nuclear test rockets, sometime between South American Inca coffee beans and North American toxic nicotine, sometime between arrive and leave, sometime between Adam and Eve. For this started some time ago, 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 and we let it. But we fell asleep a long time ago. Shukriya.
Wow.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you very much. There's a lovely, lovely woman, young lady down there who's telling me it's question and answer time. So do we have any questions? And we'll provide the answers. I will go with the lady in the blue shawl and then the gentleman behind.
Okay. First of all, I want to say that this was a most enjoyable session. There's a sense in which all poetry is meant to be heard. All poetry. So how would you define slam poetry? In what way is slam poetry different or unique?
Is that directed to me?
Anyone.
To everyone.
Anyone.
Right. Take it.
Cool. I'll give it a very, very quick answer. There's no real difference. I think slam poetry is the competitive aspect of spoken word poetry, and spoken word poetry just happens to be poetry that is performed. There's a theme. I think we can agree that there's this running theme. There's this way that you speak and the way that you get your words and you breathe. There is that aspect to it. However, as a poetry teacher as well as a performer, I encourage everything to be poetry. The back of your cereal box is poetry. It's not very good poetry. Lekin poetry to hai. If anyone else would like a crack at that question.
I would like to answer
Join Qawwali started. It was actually a performance poetry. Qawwali was a performance poetry, the origin of poems of the poems.
Thank you. Shukriya. Thank you for that quick answer. Sometimes at writers' panels, the audience get involved and give long, long, beautiful answers. They're still beautiful. Lekin hum hai, you know. We will answer your questions. But thank you. Thank you very much for that. I think the gentleman behind and then you.
Butul's poetry about cousins coming from abroad and complaining reminds me of a Urdu verse. Are sahib, itne shikwe, jaise mahabbat nahi, ehsaan karte ho.
Thank you. I believe it was... Sorry?
Kind of.
Yeah.
So my question is from all of you and telling you, it's my personal observation that the element of humor is losing out, particularly the younger generation, although it's not necessary that humorous poetry has to be coming out of happiness. At times, most of the times, it's the grief that inspires humorous poetry. So, and we have seen a couple of pieces, but very few. So what do you think? Why is that happening with the younger generation? And why do we not move towards humor to deal with sadness or to put out stuff? Because that's also more appealing to the general public.
I think that that people write the way they think and the way they feel comfortable. And so not everybody deals with pain through humor. Some people do. A lot of people do. Like
I mean, I do.
Yeah, I mean, all of us include some form of humor while you're writing. You find humor in what you're writing. But I feel like the point of spoken word and sharing it with others is like write the way you feel comfortable. So yeah, we would like people to share more humorous poetry, but again, I wouldn't tell somebody to write in a way that is appealing to the general public just because it's appealing. I want them to write what is real. I don't want them to be something they're not just because other people will like it.
Because you don't need public acceptance like right from the get-go, like or at all, honestly.
I wouldn't agree with you actually. Yeah. Like if you look at like the younger people right now, like we have memes. All we do is laugh at ourselves.
Yeah.
You know. Like but maybe not so much as in poetry because like I said earlier, like it's about catharsis.
Yeah.
So it's not coming through in the poetry, maybe. I mean it is, but not that much, but it's coming through in other ways. So we definitely are dealing with our lives with humor.
Humor
becomes a defense mechanism. So
right.
In poetry you're trying to be vulnerable. It's one of the few times that we allow ourselves to not put those walls up.
Exactly. If you can laugh at stuff, like the thing that you're very insecure about, like I'm actually very insecure about the fact that I'm bald and I sweat. But now it's just like a thing. So it's just like, hey, that's okay. That's fantastic. I made poetry out of it, you know?
Great answers. Lastly, I think they say comedy is tragedy plus time. And I think as we as young people haven't had enough time, we just keep getting more tragedies. Lekin, as I get older and more mature, I've been doing slam poetry for over a decade now. And I find I'm less angsty. I find that I'm writing more love poems. I find that I'm writing happier poems. And I think that's my time. My tragedy is slowly ending. The teenage and the early 20s angst is going away. It will go away, I promise. And it slowly becomes more happier. And I'm working on my third collection of poetry, and there is not a sad poem amongst it. This is full of sad poems. By the way, my book is available if anybody else would like to go.
Get that promo.
Next question, if we have
anyone
time. Anybody else have any questions? Yes, please.
Hi, guys. My question is
directed at all of you. What do you think is the better art form, slam poetry or rap? And how many of you would actually consider being rappers?
Damn.
I am a rapper.
Represent, thank you.
Shall I answer that?
Yeah, go ahead.
I think... Sorry, the question was, what is the difference between slam poetry and... Which one is better? I don't think you can ever claim one art form is better than another. I don't think painting is better than, you know, calligraphy. And I don't think calligraphy is better than golf. But it's an art form. Lekin, I am a rapper. I do hip-hop in Australia as well. And the... Yeah, that's my quick answer. There is no real difference between the two. It's different means of expression. Please.
I think that the way slam came out, you know, in the West was through rap. You know, it was like these marginalized communities bringing forward this kind of new, sort of less elite form of poetry. But over here, we have our Mushaira culture, you know, so that's why, like, you see the difference between how Zuhair performs and how we perform. Yeah. And, I mean, I'm not saying it's just because of culture, but that does play a huge part into it, you know. So, I mean, it's just different styles. It's the same stuff.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, I think that's a perfect place to end. That's our time up. Thank you so much for being an incredible audience. And please, our incredible audience. It's been a lot of fun. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bahut shukriya. And if anyone would like to grab a book, you can't grab it in the bookshop. This is the only place you can. Come see me at the end.
Mashallah, it's over.